Hey there, time travelers. Welcome back to another exciting journey through the groovy 70s. Today, we're diving deep into 10 things people used to have back in the day that are either banned, forgotten, or just not the norm anymore. Get ready for another batch of fascinating things and forgotten relics from this iconic era.
Oh, Arthur, this is the new Dodge Challenger RT. It's not a racer.
Hey, that.
Look at tires, them boy.
Optional polyglass GTs.
Racing tires.
Gas-guzzling cars. In the 70s, American roads were abundant with gas-guzzling vehicles. With its enormous engines and poor efficiency, the car represented power and freedom. In the 70s, the United States suffered an oil crisis, which resulted in a lack of fuel, endless lines at gas stations, and higher prices. Gas-guzzlers had turned out to be unprofitable to buy and to run. American car manufacturers used the post-war wealth growth in the country to produce large and mighty vehicles. Vehicles that satisfied buyers' demands of opulence and relaxation. Advertisements boasted about horsepower, spacious interiors, and sleek designs, attracting buyers with promises of prestige and performance. Amid the growing concerns over air pollution and environmental sustainability, the gas-guzzling cars have been on the brink of extinction. These vehicles became synonymous with pollution and relied heavily on fossil fuels. However, with the increased focus on fuel efficiency, environmental sustainability, and price competition, they are a relic of the past. Electric and hybrid vehicles have made these cars redundant, offering cost-effective and more environmentally friendly alternatives. Big hairstyles. American big hair and the obsession with over-the-top hairstyles in the 70s are an explosive combination. It became a statement of America's aesthetic and cultural expression during the late 70s, and an integral part of pop culture history. These expressions were diverse but often featured the afros, feathered hair, and other glam rock derivatives. The popularity of big hair was largely driven by the celebrity and icon culture of the 70s. For instance, Farrah Fawcett made feathered big hair fashionable, and David Bowie redefined the glam rock hairstyle. These celebrities turned absurd hairstyles into statements of glamour and individuality. Finally, the rise of big hair can be largely credited to advancements in hair care products and techniques. Blow dryers, curling irons, and styling gels and mousses made it easier and more accessible to create one's massive hair look at home. Additionally, disco and the culture surrounding it were fixated on glitz and extravagance and prioritized the look on the dance floor. But as the 70s became the 80s and fashion began shifting to a more minimalist direction, big hair eventually went out of style.
People care and you'll know it's for real. We're America's favorite drive-in folks, so join us for a meal. So when you're getting...
Drive-in restaurants with car hops. Back in the 70s, drive-in spots that had servers on wheels were all the rage. Brands like Sonic, A&W, and Dairy Queen made car hop service mega popular. The servers zipped around on skates, delivering eats straight to folks' cars. This drive-in crazy started heating up in the 50s and 60s, when car culture hit its stride. With more families owning autos, it combined grab-and-go convenience with the novelty of car hop service. These places served burgers, fries, and milkshakes. The drive-in car hop experience felt nostalgic and evoked happy memories. However, consumer tastes shifted, leading to fewer drive-ins with car hops by the 80s and 90s. Unfortunately, this nostalgic dining style faded as habits changed. People wanted convenience, and traditional drive-ins couldn't keep up. Also, suburban life changed people's routines, making drive-in dining less handy for many. Only a few car-hop drive-in eateries survive today, offering nostalgic dining experiences. Spandex. Spandex entered the scene in the 70s and changed the world of clothing in America totally by revolutionizing the apparel as well as the movement of the people. Lycra, as it is commonly denominated due to the fact that it was originally developed in the 50s by chemist Joseph Shivers, is a synthetic fiber that is known for its outstanding elasticity and great stretchiness. The stretchiness and comfort of spandex soon made it a craze in the 70s. Companies such as DuPont, which had Lycra registered as a brand name, and the giants like Nike and Adidas took to infusing spandex into their clothing line, providing the buyers with a variety of stretchy and tight wear. Spandex became an instant staple in the 70s in athletic wear, mostly in the case of the new fitness and aerobic craze that was starting. The spandex leggings, leotards, and the bodysuits eventually became what enthusiasts of exercise wore during workouts to support and provide comfort. Spandex spread its impact into the fashion industry as well, expressing the advantage of the stretchiness of the fabric for the designers to create clothing that emphasizes the curves of the body. Nevertheless, when the 70s gave way to the 80s and eventually the 90s, spandex attire went out of fashion.
Slips into this strange place, carrying the contents of a cash register. Ah, but things are not what they seem, for this is just a new kind.
Drive-through banks. Banking from cars was incredibly handy during the 70s. Drive-through banks were cool new spots to deposit checks, get cash, or handle loans. Big banks like Wells Fargo and Bank of America had them, and lots of folks used the drive-up tellers. The idea started small in the 30s when cars got big. City Center Bank in Syracuse, New York opened one in 1938. It caught on as people wanted easier ways to bank. It was super convenient for quick transactions without parking or leaving your ride. The drive-in bank boom happened as more families owned cars in the 70s. Banks realized offering this modern convenience kept customers happy and loyal. They let people handle money matters easily from their car. This approach worked well in areas with high vehicle ownership. As technology improved, drive-through banks lost appeal. Online and mobile banking allowed account access anytime, anywhere with the internet. People's habits shifted too, favoring digital over in-person banking. Drive-through banks are uncommon these days. Many have changed their purpose or new banking facilities replaced them, but you still can find some in America, especially for ATMs.
July 12, 1979, a twi-night doubleheader at Comiskey Park, the White Sox versus the Tigers.
Disco Demolition Night marked disco's peak and decline. It occurred July 12, 1979 at Comiskey Park, Chicago, Illinois. The Chicago White Sox hosted the Detroit Tigers for a doubleheader. Radio DJ Steve Dahl disliked disco music's influence. His station, WLUP, organized the event to boost ratings and express anti-disco sentiment. The idea behind Disco Demolition Night seemed straightforward. Fans could bring disco vinyl records to the stadium. These records would then be gathered and destroyed between the two baseball games that evening. However, what began as a light-hearted promotion quickly spiraled into mayhem. Thousands of fans rushed onto the field, igniting fireworks and hurling records, leaving the playing area severely damaged. The situation escalated to such an uncontrollable degree that the night's second game had to be forfeited. Disco Demolition Night exposed strong opposition to disco culture. Many considered it too pleasure-seeking and superficial. The event displayed underlying issues around race and sexuality, too. After that event, disco lost mass popularity quickly. Record companies and radio abandoned it for rock, punk, new wave. Disco faded from mainstream attention.
Save yourself a lot of trouble.
Tell you a guy that really knows.
When communication counts, you can count on Realistic. The sale priced Realistic.
CB Radio. During the 70s, CB Radio was an essential tool to connect people all over America. CB Radio was designed for military purposes back in World War II, but truckers, travelers, and radio enthusiasts started to use this technology during the 70s. Many people could connect with these simple devices and exchange essential information on the go. Truckers could share information about road conditions, traffic, possible problems they met on a way. They had their own slang and codes, which made this conversation efficient and fast, which is why the device quickly got the name Trucker's Language. CB radio was a social phenomenon, and members of enthusiast organizations could exchange information, stories, and give advice. Before the advent of telephones and networking, CB radio provided a valuable opportunity for people to connect and build solidarity. The development and spread of cell phones and the internet have suppressed the revolutionary invention involving CB radio. It is no longer a memory in the minds of the people. It is a piece of art with retro fans. While it is not a perfect medium of communication, the memories of the brotherhood and sense of belonging during CB radio's era adequately justify its importance.
With Xerox telecopier transceivers, simply by dialing an ordinary telephone, you can send copies of letters, drawings, even signatures.
Thermal fax machines. When the 70s rolled in, a new invention called thermal fax machines transformed how we shared documents. These devices used heat-sensitive paper to transmit pages quickly over long distances. Offices and businesses nationwide embraced this revolutionary communication tool. The need for speedier and more efficient workplace methods fueled the rise of thermal fax machines during that era. Panasonic, Brother, and Sharp led the pack, providing various models at different price points to accommodate diverse requirements. You would put a paper in the machine, then you would type the fax number of who you wanted to send it to. After that, you would press send. The machine would scan your paper. It would send the scanned paper as an image to the other fax machine. The other machine would print out the image on special thermal paper. These fax machines made sending documents very easy and quick. But as email got more popular, people stopped using thermal fax machines as much. Digital fax services and printers with multiple functions have replaced them. These new devices can send faxes as well as print, scan, and copy documents.
Come to where the flavor is. Come to Marlboro Country.
High school smoking areas. Back in the 70s, smoking areas were normal for high schools across the USA. Students had special spots to smoke cigarettes when classes were happening. These spots were near school buildings or outside. It showed how accepted and common smoking was in America at that time. Tobacco companies paid for events and ads in magazines, newspapers, and TV. Big brands like Marlboro and Camel were super popular with young people. Their packaging looked slick and their slogans were catchy. Smoking seemed rebellious and awesome to teens. These spaces allowed students to smoke and socialize between classes, bringing camaraderie among smokers. However, growing health concerns and anti-smoking campaigns changed attitudes. Cigarette warning labels and public initiatives reduced teen smoking rates, contributing to the decline. Many schools adopted smoke-free rules after those years. Smoking got prohibited everywhere on campuses. New laws also stopped smoking in public places like schools. This made high school smoking zones obsolete relics. Mercury thermometers. Measuring body temperature was easy with mercury thermometers in the 70s. These simple glass tubes contained a bit of liquid mercury. Households everywhere relied on their precise readings. Leading brands like Taylor, Gratherm, and BD produced various models for medical use in industrial settings. Their accuracy made them a go-to choice. The 70s saw mercury thermometers as a household staple used by parents and healthcare workers to track health conditions. The mercury enabled precise readings, making these thermometers reliable for medical purposes. But by late 20th century, concerns arose about mercury's safety. This toxic substance can harm if ingested or inhaled, with vapor exposure risking serious health issues. As awareness grew of mercury's dangers, efforts began to phase out mercury-containing products like thermometers. When questions arose about mercury's potential dangers, nations worldwide, including America, prohibited mercury thermometer sales and usage in medical facilities. Digital and infrared thermometers became safer, more convenient replacements for mercury devices. And there you have it, fellow time travelers. 10 more fascinating relics from the 70s that have either been banned, forgotten, or simply evolved with the times. Thanks for joining us on this groovy journey. Until next time, keep on groovin'.